Good afternoon. Can you hear me well at the back? Okay, let's hope so. All right. It's nice to be here. I'm for the second time at the Cosmology School last year in Kielce. I was also there, and I believe it was quite a nice school, and I hope this year it will be more or less the same. I will give it. Sorry, better. Yeah. Okay, my talk will be as this important footnote here says. It's a subjective review, so I'm not talking about all possible surveys because it's not really possible. Although I try to mention a lot of them. My talk is divided into two parts. Although I don't know whether the division will be between today and tomorrow. I will just stop at some stage today. So first part is about surveys in general and some history, and the second part will be about cosmological inference from surveys. One thing which might be a bit peculiar is that there will be hardly any equations. This is because if you want to know more, you can just go and read textbooks and papers, and I don't want, it's 3 hours is certainly not enough for a full cosmology lecture. So I mention things, but I don't usually give equations because I would have then to give the whole framework, for which I don't have time. Okay. So why do we need to survey galaxies? Why do we need to observe the large scale structure? Well, this is because the distribution of galaxies that we see results from various physical processes which have been happening since the Big Bang until now. And two, the most important ones are gravitational collapse and galaxy formation, broad terms, but they basically tell how the large scale structure forms. And by studying the statistical properties of this large scale structure, this is one of the ways to measure cosmological parameters, which within a cosmological model determine the past and future evolution of the universe. Well, about future usually it's less certain because you have to assume some physics which you cannot test, because you can only test what happened in the past, but still in a given cosmological model you can do that. And these are, for instance, mean density of matter, and you can measure both baryonic and dark matter from cosmological surveys. The cosmological constant, there are ways also to assess it from broadly seen cosmological surveys, and in particular current and past expansion rate, which are governed by these, and in particular the Hubble constant, so the current expansion rate. And keywords here, I just now mentioned a couple of them, and they will be, I will talk about more about them tomorrow: density power spectrum, galaxy correlation function, baryon acoustic oscillations, growth rate of structure. And I believe many of these, what I will say here, will be covered in more detail in the school. Here is an example of a plot from some not very recent paper, but which shows that you can constrain. This is the mean matter density here, and this is the cosmological constant. And then from different surveys, you have different contours on this plot. And by combining them, well, this one is CMB, so it's not something that I will talk about a lot, but supernovae, luminous red galaxies, so for instance, these both come from galaxy surveys in general. And one can summarize quite shortly our quite simple cosmological model, which I don't put in terms of equations here, but again, you can look it up if you are interested. And what we already know, or actually what is most consistent with observations, remembering that we always interpret our observations within a model because the universe is very complicated and we cannot just basically go into all the details. We have to assume things. And if we assume very simple Friedmann-Lemaître model, then we come to the conclusions that most of the matter in the universe is in a dark form. And this dark means that it's certainly not interacting electromagnetically, not strongly in terms of nuclear forces, but it interacts gravitationally and probably weakly, but this is a hypothesis which hasn't been proven. We also know for now almost 20 years that the universal expansion has been accelerating for a couple of billion years now, which means that dark energy in the simplest scenario is dominating the mass energy balance. We also know from already from WMAP, CMB observations confirmed later by Planck, that the universe has null curvature, which means that space is globally flat, which is a bit peculiar because we have the general relativity, which tells that space-time is always curved, etc., etc., and there is no reason that space should be flat, but it turns out that in our universe, most likely, the space is globally flat. Then, also what is, well, many people debate this, some of them will be probably even here at this school, but the big picture is that the universe is homogeneous and isotropic on the largest scales. However, this definition of the largest scales is vague. It might be 100 megaparsecs, 300 megaparsecs. And then also, a first statement is that the growth of structure in the universe is consistent with general relativity, but these constraints are not strong enough to say that many other models are ruled out. Actually, many other models are still consistent with that. But certainly, it is consistent with GR. However, there are many other questions, and actually probably even more if you go into details about what we don't know, or we don't know fully, or we don't understand. What is dark matter? We don't know really. There are hypotheses, there are models, but nothing, in particular no particles have been detected which are consistent with dark matter. What is dark energy? This is even more mysterious because we don't really have a physical clue what it should be. So it might be just simple cosmological constant, basically a term in Einstein equations. It can be something like of negative pressure, or maybe it's an artifact of an overly simplistic model, or it might be some manifestation of modified gravity, which is also related to this point, whether GR is correct on the largest scales. These are things still to be tested. So I said that the universe is isotropic and homogeneous, but how large are the scales really? There are different methods to assess this, and they usually come with a conclusion that about 100, 200 megaparsecs, but this transition also is not very strong. An interesting question is whether we are a typical observer. So the cosmological principle and related to that Copernican principle says that we are not a privileged observer. We are, in a sense, a random observer, but this is certainly not true because a random observer in the universe would be located somewhere in the middle of a void. We are on a planet, which is in a solar system, which is in a galaxy, in a particular place, and this galaxy also is not in a random place in the universe. The question is how important this is for what we infer about the universe. And there are some things where this is quite important, actually. Although we believe that it's not important for the big picture, the cosmological model itself. And then there are some details, many of which will be discussed here. History of galaxy formation, build-up of galaxies from primordial gas, details of collisions and mergers of galaxies, which we simulate, but it's difficult to really do it in very large details. Build-up of galaxy clusters and large-scale voids. We have a general picture of this from simulations, which we will hear a lot over the next 2 days, I think. So tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. But this doesn't solve everything because we cannot go to infinitely small scales with the simulations, really. And this is just to give a general examples of some things that I will be talking more about tomorrow. Examples of how do you use large scale structure surveys to infer cosmological information. One of them is the baryon acoustic oscillations. I will give more details tomorrow probably, but in general, these are frozen relics of sound waves which are propagating through the early universe before the decoupling of matter and radiation, and they left an imprint in galaxy correlations. So this is a very simple model how more or less it looks like. So you have a sound wave propagating around some overdensity, and at some moment it freezes. Of course, this is more complicated than this simple picture, but this is the idea. You can measure the primordial scale in a sense from the CMB, and you can measure also this imprint in 2 days galaxy surveys. which gives you a standard ruler, so you can translate the angle that you measure on the sky to a to a size. So from that, from simple geometry, then you can measure the distance to this thing. So it gives you basically the rate of expansion, and it's one of the very strong strong evidences that, the acceleration has been expanding. Another one, which is very difficult to measure but is very very important, is the Sachs-Wolfe effect. Is an effect that when photons cross the under densities and the over densities, the photons of the CMB, then they gain energy when they enter the gravitational well, and then they lose energy, and this depends on how the universe evolves. And this, if in a flat universe as ours, if this effect is detected, this means that that there is cosmological constant. These are very simple things. And basically, the fact that this has been detected and that we know that the universe is flat means that you cannot have only matter in the universe. You have also to have cosmological constant. Again, in the simplest model in which we work, the lambda CDM model in general. How the large-scale structure build up also we know quite well already. We know that it formed from the primordial density fluctuations, which are imprinted in the cosmic microwave background, of which we have now very, very nice picture from Planck. This is the best all-sky CMB picture that we've ever had. On smaller sizes of the sky, we have better resolved picture from ground-based surveys, but for the whole sky, this is the best one that we have. And this tells us how more or less the universe was looking around 400,000 years after the Big Bang. And we also have galaxy surveys, about which I will talk a lot today, from which we know how the universe looks today. And so this is basically a projection of the whole celestial sphere. And we know that this evolved from that. The important part thing is that these fluctuations in the temperature were very tiny back then. And actually now the fluctuations are much larger, because we have galaxies, we have clusters of galaxies, and we also have in between them voids. Okay. Mm-hmm. And thanks to cosmological simulations, we know many details how this forms, and in particular we know that we need, this is one of the evidences for dark matter, that we need dark matter to form the large-scale structure as we see it, because we wouldn't be able to form the universe in a form as it is without dark matter as the skeleton of this. Mm-hmm. And this is a simple picture of simulation results where you see the evolution of the large-scale structure. The thing that is taken out from here is the universal expansion, so this whole box should be also expanding. So in general, this is the gravitational instability mechanism. The overdense regions collapse. So this is exactly as the name says, it's instability. So once you have some denser regions, they start to collapse, and they collapse more and more. And for large scale structure, it means that you create galaxies, clusters, and superclusters of galaxies. But then if you have some regions that collapse much faster than the universal expansion, then that means that you also will have empty spaces which will become emptier and emptier. They will be cleaned up of structure. And it means that if you look at them from another perspective, that they expand faster than the background, and they become voids of densities much lower than the average. And all this results in the so-called cosmic web. So the galaxies are organized again. This is again a projection on the sky, so it's a 2D projection. But you clearly see the so-called filaments. This is actually our local supergalactic plane. This is a supercluster in Shapley. You also have here, for instance, there is Coma galaxy cluster and another supercluster here. In between, even on the 2D projection, you see that there are empty spaces, voids. But this picture already, if you look at redshift of 1, which was several billion years ago, you already see that the large-scale structure in this form was already more or less there. The colors here are just the colors of galaxies from their observed colors, as far as I remember. So they don't mean much for this picture, but the point is that you see filaments and voids between them. Okay. So how do we know all of this? So we know this from many, many years, many decades of observations, but mostly that we have to try to see the universe in a representative way. We want to target large samples of the sky. So we want to cover large areas of the sky because we want to, for instance, to test isotropy of the universe. We want to see if the universe is the same in different directions. And also we want to go deep in photometry, deep in spectroscopy. So we want to go far from us as possible. And then, of course, as in time because of the finite speed of light. And the most successful of these, arguably at the moment, has been still the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. It already has 3 million extragalactic spectra on quarter of the sky. And even this extremely successful survey has to make these trade-offs between how much of the sky it will cover and how deep it will reach. So to go to larger distance, for instance, galaxies are preselected in a certain way. This is because the wide-angle 3D distribution to observe is expensive and time-consuming. And this is the basically the end of a short introduction, and I would like to go a bit back, almost 300 years back first, to show a small historical overview how we came to this from very early efforts. So with naked eye from the Earth, as far as I know, we can see one or maybe two, well, in the north two maybe, in the south two more extragalactic objects, which are the M31, I think M33 can be seen by eye. The Magellanic Cloud certainly, I saw them in South Africa even in a not very, very, very dark night. But other than that, people didn't know that there is something there on the sky until people start to look for things which are different than stars, basically. And from what I found, I'm not a science historian, this is a caveat here, so you can correct me if you know better than that, but that's what I was able to find. So the first one who cataloged some the so-called nebulae was Nicolas Louis de la Caille in the southern sky. And then the famous Charles Messier, who was looking for comets, and there were these blurry things that were interfering because they were not moving on the sky, but they were as blurry as comets. So he cataloged them. He cataloged, I think he cataloged less than that, but then it was added. So there are 103 objects in Messier catalog, so they have this M something number. But these are general nebulae. And then these two, father and son, very famous, William and John Herschel, in the 18th and 19th century, they started cataloging nebulae on a regular basis because they had telescopes which were useful for that. So very large, basically, not in the mirror size, but they started targeting nebulae, and they made what is now called New General Catalog. So I found this funny entry from this funny thing, 1873, where people were drawing what they see through their telescopes. They were already photographing them as well, I believe, but these clearly are drawings. What kind of nebulae people were seeing. Now we know that these are clusters of stars, planetary nebulae, but there are also these spirals, these other things. And already in 19th century, Immanuel Kant speculated, without, of course, knowing this, that there might be some island universes, kind of, that we are might be one of them, so galaxies, as we call them now. And important finding by John Herschel was that the clusters, the nebulae on the sky are located quite independently than the stars are. And this is basically the first discovery of the large-scale structure of the universe. He basically discovered that, for instance, there is the Virgo cluster, but he didn't know that, of course. And this is a catalog. This is a proof that the nebula really clusters. So these are the stars here, the Milky Way. So this, most of the stars are here that we see on the sky, but nebulae are, for instance, here. So totally independently of the Milky Way. What are the spiral nebulae came to be known around 1920s? And here I would like to thank Elena Panko for correcting some things that I had last year here. So I added some input from her. But the important point is that I would like you to remember what there is a large misunderstanding that I even saw recently in a news release in a Polish popular press. Something that was about redshifts, etc. Edwin Hubble did not measure the first redshifts of galaxies. Vesto Slipher measured the first redshifts of galaxies. Already in 1913, I think the first one was M31, and that was a blue shift. But soon after that, he measured several nebulae, and he measured that they have hundreds of kilometers per second. Redshifts, so recession velocities, and he actually wrote in one of the papers that it's very unlikely that these are something that are connected to the what we call now the galaxy. But he was not brave enough to go further, but he wrote it really. And then there were people who estimated distances to M31 much larger than you could imagine the size of our galaxy. And there was a famous great debate, which, as far as I know, didn't really lead to any conclusion because people stuck to what they thought. But some people claim that spiral systems are some funny systems inside our galaxy, and that others said already there, like Heber Curtis, had reasons to believe that the nebulae are outside of our galaxy, are some other systems. Well, it was settled soon. Also thanks to Edwin Hubble, that I have to confess, it's not that he didn't really contribute at all, or he didn't contribute maybe as much as people often believe, but he measured that the Andromeda Nebula is clearly not in our Milky Way, because it, according to his measurements, was hundreds of thousands of light years.
Sorry, interrupting watching, but if you want to try to give them justice, you should also mention Humason, who was Hubble's.
Yeah, Humason will be later, but this was not redshifts yet. Yeah, this was just the redshift independent distance. So anyway, there was an issue because Hugh Cepheid said he had some issue with distances to Cepheids that was solved later, but so he was not giving the proper value, but clearly that was the resolution of this. And soon afterwards, when Hubble joined measurements of redshifts, which mostly came from this guy, so on here, and redshift independent distances that came from him, as far as I understand, he made the famous Hubble law. Although if you tell me that you see a linear relation among these points, I don't think you would pass your statistics classes. This was just a guess, really, especially that these are negative here, if you look.
You can compute the coefficients and see what it
is. Well, you can fit probably some quadratic relation if you want, whatever. It was an educated guess, but as far as I know, again, the funny thing about Hubble is that he never really wrote that the universe is expanding. He found this relation, but okay. I don't want to get more into this because I don't want to start a quarrel here about this, but this is what came as the Hubble law. So the redshifts are in the local universe linearly dependent with distance of galaxies. So the universe is not only very large, it's also not static, which I don't show here, but was totally consistent with already existing solutions of Einstein equations for very simple cosmological models by Friedman and Lemaître independently. But this talk is about, this lecture is about large scale structures, so I will pass directly to the efforts to learn more about the overall distribution of the large scale structure. I must say that Hubble also contributed a lot. If you look into, there are papers in 1930s where he was looking in the distribution of the nebula on the sky. But here I go directly to some more modern efforts, in particular, how the galaxies are distributed. So already first Shapley and then also Fritz Zwicky and then George Hubble after the war, they found that galaxies cluster. So they not randomly on the sky located, but they really like to gather. In 1933, Gérard de Vaucouleurs came up with an idea that actually galaxies around us are in a flattened structure which he called supergalaxy. And I understand that back then it was very controversial. He was not basically believed. Now we really know that there is what we call supergalactic plane, but he was not really believed a lot. Then in 1960s, there were first catalogs of angular distribution of galaxies, so basically just photographs from which you can infer that the distribution of the galaxies, but you don't know the third dimension from this, of course, but you also see that they cluster. So this is like a density plot here, and there are some clusters here and there.
May I make a comment?
Yes, please.
I take only 2 minutes. There is, yeah, this is nice, but however, there are one comment is Zwicky, and the other one is Gérard de Vaucouleurs. Zwicky at the time was thinking, and I have a plot made by sense, so I know what I'm saying. Consider a different kind of universe, because at the time of Zwicky, till 1970, he thought there was a background of galaxies on which clusters are superimposed. And that background actually is not as you show it, there is a filamentary structure. So the conception Zwicky had at the time of the whole thing was not the way we know nowadays. The other comment I wanted to make, and I have a plot, in fact, I tell you, I published it. So the other comment I wanted to say about Gérard de Vaucouleurs, by the way, you got a colleague in Austin. It is true that he did develop this super galaxy or local supercluster. However, the idea Gérard had at the comet at the time was of a supercluster kind of as a bound system, almost like a galaxy rotating. And his conception, there is a beautiful, however, paper, you know, the conception he had of the universe was kind of an hierarchical universe. So that of the way, I think actually, Curtis would mention. So, and as we know now, the supercluster is too big, so that there was no time for the structure to relax. So it's one of the various superclusters, in the sense that we know, and of course the Virgo cluster is part of that. And then I finish, I say only another trick to make, because you mentioned Shapley in the previous slide.
Yes.
And it's true, yes, probably. But probably should also mention that one who did look, the first one to look into superstructure was actually Shapley, because if you know that the first catalog to 13 magnitude was made by the group of
yes.
Shapley at Harvard, and then he did actually a lot of Southern Super. He had a bunch of girls working for him. So he did a lot of extragalactic astronomy. It's not that he thought only that the metagalaxy actually was related to Shapley. Well, I wanted just to.
Okay, thank you. Sure. Thank you for. For these corrections, I don't judge. I know that Fritz Zwicky actually had an idea. Well, he didn't. He claimed that redshifts are not related to a universal expansion actually. So, but I only managed to find that. Well, he was looking at the coma cluster, for instance. So I just mentioned him as one of these who contributed to the. To our knowledge, the galaxies are clustered.
You know, 6 volume of galaxy clusters.
Yes, he also made catalogs later. Yes. Well, anyway, let's move on, because there's certainly no time to cover all the historical aspects. Now we will go to a bit more, more modern times. And again, it's a selective and subjective review, so sorry for that. I cannot really mention everything, but I just try to honor. those about which I know. So in particular, in the late 1970s, it was we now say that discovered, but I back then it was more claimed than discovered, that the universe has something like a sponge structure, which we now call the cosmic web. And in particular, those two, the group of Jana Inasto in Estonia, the former Soviet Union, and for instance, there is a paper also from Gregory and Thompson, who both of them, in different words, basically said that there are, in between galaxies, there are empty spaces which are not selection effects, as they claim, because this was the main concern back then, that maybe they just didn't measure the galaxies which are there. This picture was very soon confirmed once the massive measurements of redshift came in, and this era of 3D galaxy surveys, first of all, uses the fact that I mentioned already, the Hubble law in the local universe, and also in farther away universe, that you can use the redshift as a measure of the distance of a galaxy in the local universe, more or less this relation when I took. You can calculate how large H naught I took, so you can check on which side of the discussion about Hubble constant I am. And then large redshift surveys were possible thanks to the CCD, the thing that we now have in all our mobiles and all our cameras. As far as I know, in large application basis came into in astronomy, probably also into military at the same time or before, but astronomy really very much pushed a lot this. And then the multi-fiber spectroscopy, so that you can measure not only one galaxy at a time with your telescope, but you can measure several spectra by putting fibers. This resulted in three-dimensional maps that we can now make. And here I give examples of how you can picture the 3D information that you have. So this one is a so-called cone plot where we are here, and this is distances. This is one of the angular coordinates, and the other one is projected. This is a projection on the sky, as I already showed. So this is basically a 2D information, but you can color code your galaxy if you want with redshift. Then it's so-called hockey puck, which was very much liked by, as far as I understand, John Hakra, who was from Boston, where they play hockey, so that's why it was called hockey puck, I understand. But the thing is that basically we are in the middle, and you project a cylinder onto a circle. And then there is a slice where, again, we can be anywhere here, but you just picture the, you just project two dimensions of a 3D box on a plot. And this picture of this large-scale structure, as we now see, was emerging in the 80s, in particular thanks to surveys from the Harvard team. This very famous picture of the so-called Stickman is actually a manifestation of something I will talk about tomorrow, the redshift space distortions. I mean, this funny thing is because this is a cluster, and I think this is coma cluster, if I remember correctly. And actually, all these galaxies are more or less in the same place, in a sphere, but we measure them in redshift space, that's why they are so elongated in this direction. I will talk about this tomorrow more. Soon after that, well, actually before this paper, but more or less at the same time, people started also to try to measure the universe from satellites, and in particular to produce first all sky maps of the universe. And the first one to do that with some sufficient accuracy was, sufficient sensitivity was the IRAS satellite, which operated in mid and far infrared. And it detected about 350,000 infrared sources, most of which were not known to the humankind, I can say. I mean, sources detected the first time. The important thing is it's not a redshift survey, it's just a photometric survey. And most of these are in our galaxy, actually, but many of these are outside our galaxy. And this gave a basis for the first all-sky redshift survey. So people selected probable galaxies from IRAS, and they measured them with ground-based telescope. They measured the spectra, and constructed the first. Well, it covered around 84% of the sky, so it was the closest to all-sky that people had for many years. And even here again, you see basically that the our supergalactic plane is clearly seen even in this very simple plot. Okay. Then with the technological advancement, people started to think how to target specific parts of the sky, use the technology that was available back then, and in particular, very successful 2DF galaxy redshift survey done with a telescope in Australia, but mostly by a British and a bit also Australian team, was the first one of such a massive redshift survey. So they measured over 200,000 galaxies on quite a small fraction of the sky, but they went quite deep, as far as the back then standards were concerned, so to redshift of 0.2. And this was the first survey that really, well, except, well, the IRAS was also used for cosmology abundantly, but this one gave, for instance, one of the two first measurements of the baryon acoustic oscillations. Then came also the idea that, okay, now we have good CCD technology, and let's try to measure the universe in a consistent way. Let's try to make all sky surveys. And the first one to do it from the ground, the first one to do it in the near-infrared was TUMAS. Near-infrared is very important for the local RC structure, because most of the stellar light, which most of the stars are stars of the types, so the redder than the sun, so the so-called late types, and most of this stellar light is emitted in the near infrared. So if you observe the universe in local universe in the near infrared, then you observe most of the stellar mass basically. And because we have reasons to believe that the stellar mass traces very well the dark matter, then measuring the stellar mass traces very well the general large scale structure. And again, although this is just a 2D survey without any redshifts, you see the large scale structure very clearly in here. Without any, you don't do any tricks to this. This is just what you see. And this is there is over 1 million galaxies in this catalog, and there are also 500 million stars which were nicely taken away mostly from this picture to see the extragalactic sources here. Then came era of really very large surveys and very record-breaking things, in particular SDSS, which has been running for almost two decades now and already has fourth stage. So they have stage one, stage two, stage three, and they move now to stage four. And they had already 13 data releases, but I already saw papers from DR14, although the release hasn't been made yet. So they are constantly observing, in spectroscopy some 25% in the sky. Now they also observe a lot of stars, so this is not only an extragalactic survey anymore. But in terms of the extragalactic science, this is the largest spectroscopic catalog of galaxies and quasars so far in terms of one homogeneous survey. Although it's not that homogeneous, because going to larger depths, the galaxies are preselected in specific colors to target some specific galaxy types. But this is, as I what I mentioned before, that there is a trade-off. You cannot really observe everything. It's just not feasible, because you have to measure, you need some time to measure each spectrum. But additionally, SDSS also is a photometric survey. So this is the very first, I think, of such examples where they not only measure redshifts, but they also photographed the sky in five bands. So they have about 200 million galaxies with photometry. People also continue all the time to also do go the other way, when you also don't measure redshifts, but you want to cover gather a lot of information, and you can do it sometimes even in quite small instruments if you send them to space, for instance. So the WISE surveys, the WISE instrument is a very nice example of this. It's a very small 40 centimeter telescope, but it was quite groundbreaking in terms of its sky coverage. So it measured the whole sky in bands which are not easily, most of them are not accessible from the air, from the ground. because of the of our atmosphere. So they emit infrared. So again, 3.5 micron is still a bit of stellar light, and especially if you go to larger redshifts, then you start seeing mostly the stellar light from this. So this is again very useful for that. And it has a catalog of 750 million sources. But the problem is that because of the low angular resolution and not many bands, it's difficult to say what these are. And you just have you can just make a plot of all the sources which are there. And this thing is here is an instrumental artifact because it's WISE is on a orbit around the Earth, and it has some issues with the coolant. But anyway, you see that mostly it sees galactic stars. This is a logarithmic scale here, but basically most of these here are galaxies really, and there are also lots of quasars in there. So this is basically the deepest all sky survey so far, and the funny thing is that if you think what is the largest in terms of the optical magnitude, so this which we see with our eyes, the largest catalog so far is based on old photographic plates. There is nothing more modern than that. Here I mentioned that this will be in a way replaced by Gaia, the satellite which is observing now and has already had one release. But Gaia is only measuring stars, so anything that is not consistent with a star, with being a point source, is removed already on board of the telescope, because the amount of information that Gaia brings in, the measures, is too large to transmit it to the Earth. And because it's a survey of stars in our galaxy, although it does detect galaxies, the galaxies are removed. So there will be not anything from Gaia which can supersede this in terms of extragalactic sources. Well, this thing is based on a photographic plates, and photographic plates have many issues, but from 2 billion catalog sources, about 10% are useful, but I will show that actually they can be used also for large-scale structure studies. And here I have a couple of plots that I borrowed from John Peacock, where he basically made a plot of the year, the calendar year here, and then the logarithmic number of redshifts that were available to humankind. And here you start with Slipher and you start, of course, with zero. So on the logarithmic scale is somewhere there. And then the first one was Slipher. Then the second one, who brought a lot of redshifts in, with also then Mayol and Sandage, was Humason mentioned by Wojtek. And actually there is another funny story that so Hubble used redshifts from Slipher first and then mostly from Humason. Okay, he is on some of the papers, but he's not on the Hubble law, for instance, and maybe he should. So this is, well, anyway, he did measure redshifts. Then you have to go, so you see that it was really slow progress because each galaxy was measured one by one. And the revised Shapley AMS catalog is already 1980s, but then it started to accelerate. The CFA surveys that I mentioned, there were two of them. Then there was the 2DF, and also Las Campanas Redshift Survey, a bit less known, but also quite, you see, that already kept this pace. And then this pace continued with SDSS. And now this is supposed to continue with new instruments, DESI. Here Wojtek may know better because he is in this project. I had some figures that's planned for next year, but I don't think it's
more or less on the scale.
The telescope is probably there,
a slight delay as usual, but it's nothing to.
Anyway, it's supposed to measure hundreds of millions redshifts or tens of millions, certainly. Yeah. 20 million redshifts certainly, and then there will be Euclid if everything goes as planned, which should bring, you see, that even should accelerate this. And after that, I don't know, because it will be difficult to find something more expensive than Euclid, for sure. So, well, and this plot here is this line here. Hubble Ultra Deep Field is basically the deepest that you could imagine going.
What about SKA magic?
Yeah, SK is not here, but that's mostly because I think John didn't really know. SK doesn't really have. I'm not sure if there are really specific plans how many redshifts there will be, because it's not decided whether there will be SK. But SK should also add to this, maybe doing this here. Okay. So to summarize this part about the large surveys, etc. This is the present state. of the surveys, those which are ongoing, and here I mix spectroscopic and photometric surveys. This is because they are equally important, I think, and some of them can do much better than the others in some aspects. And I, as I mentioned, and this is just a selective list, of course, SDSS, galaxies and quasars, and also stars now, but from extragalactic science, these two. It's happening now, and it's continuing. I don't know whether there are plans to shut it down ever. then there is the largest in terms of the sky coverage. If you think of very deep surveys and very large sky coverage, this is the largest that will be dark energy survey before Euclid. It will bring optical photometry on 5,000 square degrees. I don't know what is exact status of the survey, but this summer we are expecting many papers from their first two or three years even of measurements. Then there is a survey in which I am involved, and we measure also, it's also a photometric survey, but a bit with better photometry than this, on smaller angular scales. But what is important, we have both optical and near-infrared photometry. And then there is an excellent survey that has started recently, where they use the Subaru telescope, 8-meter telescope or even larger, to measure photometry, and they are excellent really in what they get. They can measure it very fast, and they will have similar sky coverage as kids, much smaller than this, but they will go much deeper. They will have much better photometry. And there are many, many others. An important thing is that these already now are terabytes of data if you sum all of them. I don't think it's already petabytes here, but it's certainly terabytes. On my disks, for instance, from data release 3 of this survey, I have a catalog which has 50 gigabytes, and these are just selected columns from the whole catalog. So these are really terabytes of data already that we are speaking about. However, near and maybe more remote future of wide angle surveys is petabytes of data. And here are a couple of examples. Again, I have to start with one that I'm loosely involved in, is a Taipan, which targets hemispherical spectroscopy of rather local galaxies, but wants to be quite complete in that. It's supposed to start very soon, so the instruments are there, and we'll start measuring maybe later this year. Then there is DESI that I mentioned. So okay, I found some 30 million galaxies figure. Then there is the telescope, which I understand is funded, but it's not really being built yet because there are precursors to that. But it's an extremely ambitious project of putting arrays of radio telescopes. And one of the surveys that can be made with them will be also redshift survey, where you observe the redshift at 21 centimeter hydrogen emission. And the dates are here unclear, but 2020s maybe. Euclid, which is a plant, well, very advanced in planning, I would say. Already there is a huge team working on Euclid for many years, which is supposed to be groundbreaking in a sense that it will measure photometry, but from space, which has so far with this was done mostly with Hubble Space Telescope, but other than that, it was not really done in the near infrared with what Euclid can give. And it will also have redshifts, but it will be funny slitless spectroscopy. So like if you, a kind of a prism from which you put light, and then you get redshifts on your CCD together. And so it's not exactly the same as this, for instance, where you just put fibers on where galaxies are. And there is another one. This one is really advanced, and it will happen. Recently, Poland joined this, so I'm also involved now in this survey, luckily, because it's very, very nice project which will have not only large-scale structure, but also the important thing it will be that we'll be scanning the whole sky every night, the whole available sky. So it will bring not only the very good photometric information, but also the time resolution. So it will be useful for many, many branches of astronomy. And the predictions there are it will have like 40 billion sources, something like that. And for instance, the funny thing about this is that when you ask the people from the survey whether the data will be publicly available, they say yes, but you cannot transfer it through the internet. You have to bring your your kind of machine or something to store whatever there will be, because this is just too large. So there will be a database in Chile, there will be a database in the US, and there is a special connection being built, already built, that connects the two. And there will be also a database in France. So this will be where you can go with your disk, I don't know what, and then take the data if you want, but you cannot expect them to put it on Dropbox or somewhere. I mean, unless there is some huge breakthrough in technology where we can store efficiently and transfer petabytes of data. So that's important. If you want to use LSSD data, you better join LSSD, because otherwise it will be quite challenging. Okay. So now to just a quick overview of some of these surveys that I briefly mentioned here, to come back to some of the largest and most important in terms of very wide angles. And I mentioned already Tumas, and I already showed a reverse picture of this. This one is maybe more better because galaxies probably are brighter than the background. So the important thing about this catalog is that it has 1 million galaxies. Basically all the extended sources here are confirmed galaxies, except of some which are the galactic plane. So if you want to use certain galaxies in our local universe, this is the catalog to use. If you want to use All Sky Survey, which has redshifts, the IRAS PSCZ that I mentioned was superseded in a sense by a larger catalog, which is the Tumas Redshift Survey. So people preselected from Tumas a subsample of galaxies. Again, an important thing about this is that it's a complete sample in terms of the flux limit. So this measures all the galaxies which are up to this magnitude, which is a very shallow magnitude. So it's a very local catalog of redshift less than 0.1, most of them. But so it traces just really the nearby structures, and from this map that you can find on Tom Jarrett's page, on the two MRS pages, you can really see many, many local structures which are there. Okay. Then also, so because this Tumas survey, which is a photometric survey, so that's why it's black and white on this plot, because we don't know distances easily from this plot, from this survey, people try to add something more to 2MRS to make a larger catalog from redshifts from other surveys like SDSS and SIGDFS, for instance. But what can be built from that is still limited, especially in part of the northern sky when there is only 2MRS. But you can still do cosmology with that, and this is an example of a paper from it. Okay, now, so I said that from Tumas it's not easy to get distances to galaxies, which is partly true, but not fully true, because over the years people have realized that you can try to estimate distances, or rather redshifts, of galaxies even if you don't measure the spectroscopic redshift. And this is possible to the multi-wavelength approach, where you try to measure the same sources in many wavelengths, and in particular you can either try to do it with a dedicated survey, or you can try to join surveys which already exist. So you can, when you join different photometric catalogs, you can for instance estimate the redshift, which I will show in the next slide how it works. The point is that you can try to estimate it from flux variations, and an example is shown in this plot. So these are spectra of some galaxies at three different redshifts, 0, 0.5 and 1. And here are the broadband filters. And you see that this is actually the same type of galaxy as far as I understand. When you go to high redshifts, two things happen. First of all, that there is the redshift, so the whole spectrum moves, the lines move, but also, of course, there is on average flux goes down, because the further galaxies from you, the dimmer you see it. The important thing about this technique of photometric redshifts is that you can really get quasi 3D distribution of millions of galaxies much, much faster and much cheaper than ever from spectroscopy. Much faster means that you can use algorithms and you can run them overnight or maybe a bit longer, depends how sophisticated the algorithm is, for millions of galaxies. The negative sides of this are that the precision of the estimated redshifts, by precision I mean exactly that, what is meant in statistics, that there is a large scatter about the mean value. The precision is usually much, well, is always much worse than from spectroscopy, and at best case scenario where the redshifts spectroscopic are not very good and these photometric are very, very good, it's by two orders of magnitude, so you cannot really go better.
Well, there are, what do you mean by two orders of magnitude?
Well, it means that normally you measure spectroscopic redshift with some precision 10 to minus 4, 10 to minus 5. Yes? Well, you have an error on your spectroscopic redshifts always.
Mm-hmm, yes,
so from photometric redshifts, you will have precision of 10 to minus 3, 10 to minus 2 in terms of means, in terms of scatter.
You should show a graph, but anyway, okay.
I will show a graph, no worries. My point is that it is an efficient technique for large scale inference, but not if you want to measure galaxy by galaxy. And more generally, you can do SED fitting, which you learn about next week, and you can measure estimate not only the redshift but also many galaxy properties from this. So this is an example of. This is some more details how these photometric redshifts can be done. As I mentioned, that there is a cosmological shift of lines of the whole continuum, and also mean decrease in bolometric flux. And of course, there is galaxy evolution. All these change the spectrum of a galaxy. The point is that there are wavelength-dependent magnitude changes. So how the magnitudes you measure change depend on the wavelength. And then you can apply either SED fitting, or you can apply so-called machine learning when you do sometimes it's thought as a bit of magic, that, but the point is that you try to fit a mean relation between your observed galaxy properties and the redshift to infer redshift for galaxies for which you only have these observed properties like magnitudes. So you have to train it on a sample where you do have spectroscopic redshifts, and then you can infer the photometric redshifts. An example here is from my own work with collaborators, where we constructed two catalogs, and one of them is based on Tumas. So although I said that you cannot infer distances of these, well, if you make some effort, you can, thanks to the fact that we now have the WISE that I mentioned and the supercosmos, so you can basically cover the wavelengths of all, practically all Tumas galaxies from the blue band up to 4.5 micron. And if you join it with large spectroscopic samples for training, which were shown basically here, so you have lots of redshifts in Tumas, you can infer the 3D information from photometric redshifts with, of course, limited precision. Oh, sorry, so I don't have a plot which shows it. No, I don't have it. But basically, there is a nice one-to-one correspondence between the spectroscopic redshifts and the photometric ones, and we can infer precision of 12% on average for this. And this is not, if you want to say that this given Tumas galaxy has this redshift, it's not sufficient, but it's sufficient for various cosmological applications where you don't need exact information in the third dimension, but you want to have some information. And actually, photometric redshifts, if I go quickly back to slide about the surveys like these, this survey, and this survey are totally based on photometric redshifts because there is no way you can, because already this one has already now 20 million galaxies, this one probably will have hundreds of millions of galaxies, there is no way to measure all the redshifts of them. And this survey will be practically only a photometric redshift survey in terms of the cosmological approach. I mean, I don't know how many of these will be galaxies, but there is no way you can measure them spectroscopically in a lifetime or in a humanity time, I would say, unless everybody starts measuring redshifts all the time. So anyway, we made catalogs, and this one was followed with another one. Now I will very quickly go through nice pictures that Tom Jarrett made based on Tumas, where you basically take slices at different redshift. This is the end product, so each color here is a different redshift from 0 to 0.15, more or less. So 0 is violet and 0.15 is red. And then you can slice it up and see structures emerging at different redshifts. And here I give this more or less the distances of these sources, and you see how the large scale structure changes in different redshift shells. And as I say, every redshift of every of these galaxies is not precise, but if you take quite broad shells, you really have quite a nice picture of the large scale structure. Okay. And one question that I would like to ask you, does anybody know? So if you look here, the span of the distances is from some moment growing. So this was, okay, 60 megaparsecs, and then now it's already, okay, 80. Do you know why, however, there are fewer and fewer galaxies, although the shells are broader and broader? Does anybody know that? Does anybody notice why this might be? So TUMAS is a flux-limited survey, okay? This means that you measure everything up to a given flux, the flux that you detect with your telescope. But galaxies don't have one single true magnitude. They have many different magnitudes. So this means that if you go deeper and deeper in terms of the flux or magnitude, you start seeing only brighter and brighter galaxies. So when you go pass through what you can call volume limit of your survey, you start only seeing the brighter and brighter galaxies. So then it means that even if you take broader and broader shells, your number density of galaxies is getting smaller. But there is no way to overcome this, because you cannot, if you don't know redshifts a priori, you cannot make a redshift limited survey. You say, I measure everything to redshift 4.3. There is no way to do it, because what you measure are, you measure fluxes first, and then you have to measure redshift afterwards. Anyway, this is how it looks like. And then also Tom made a nice, so this comes from an older version, but also a finder chart, which is very similar to MRS1, but three times deeper than that. And this is the most complete all-sky survey that exists so far. And I'm not sure if it will be soon overcome by something else. Here I just very briefly give examples. I said that using photometric redshifts for cosmology can be done if you're not interested in precise radial information. Here are some examples where some with my involvement, where people used 2MPZ, as we called it, 2MPZ, as we called it, for some cosmological applications. For me, very interesting is this one. So before the first GW event was announced, already people contacted me and my collaborators about possibility of using the catalogs to look for electromagnetic counterparts. So if you have a collision of two black holes, normally you don't expect electromagnetic counterparts to be seen, although there are some models which predict this. But if you have a collision of a black hole with neutron star or of two neutron stars, except of gravitational waves that you will measure from that, you also expect electromagnetic counterparts at various wavelengths, in particular probably in the gamma rays. But anyway, when you look for a counterpart of this event that is announced to you, you need to know where to look, more or less. And the thing is that it's more probable that neutron stars and black holes will be inside galaxies than outside of them. So it is more useful to first target your optical telescope or infrared telescope or gamma ray telescope to a part where there are more galaxies. And this is explored in, for instance, these two papers, but was also used in one of the LIGO official papers. So then you need some local large-scale structure maps, and 2MPZ is very useful for the nearby structure for that, because the precision that the gravitational wave events give you in terms of the distance of the source is actually very similar to the precision that we have from photometric redshifts at the moment. So this is a very, very interesting thing, and we still have to wait first neutron star black hole collision, for instance, but then it should be useful. Okay, actually people also, sorry for this, it's slided a bit, but actually I mentioned that TUMAS measured also lots of stars. This means that in TUMAS there are also point sources, and people showed that except of galaxies which are in the catalogs that I discussed a lot here, there are also many galaxies in the point source catalog of TUMAS. The problem is that you can show that they are there, and you can measure their redshift distribution more or less as is shown here from what is called clustering redshifts, but there is no obvious way to extract these sources. And this is because how the clustering redshift method works. And this is a very interesting novel method of estimating not individual redshifts, but of redshift distributions. So there are applications where You have a sample of galaxies, for instance, in weak gravitational lensing. You more or less know at which redshifts they are, but you don't care really for individual galaxies. You just want to know what is the redshift distribution of them. So or probability, if you think redshift is here and the probability is here. Because you want to measure some cosmology from that, so you want to know the redshift distributions. And this technique is very interesting one to measure, to estimate this. Basically, it boils down to the fact that if you have a photometric only sample, so you only have magnitudes, and on this same patch of sky you have a spectroscopic sample, so you have precise redshifts. It can be totally an independent sample of this photometric one. Then, if they actually are in the same redshift range, then if you measure the angular correlations, there should be signal, because if there is no signal, it means they are not correlated, so they are at different redshifts. Or actually one is maybe stars, but you assume that you eliminated stars already from that. So you can cross-correlate some spectroscopic sample with your photometric sample, and then you can estimate redshift distribution of your photometric sample. And this is an example from this paper, where these are estimates. You select in some redshift, photometric redshift beams, and then you estimate from overlap with spectroscopic samples. And it has been applied to many surveys. And Tuma's application is basically shown here. So this is a really promising technique, especially for LSST, where it will be also challenging to get precise photometric redshifts, but you may need to know redshift distributions of the samples. So you can go to some quite small bins here, but you will never be able to really measure individual galaxies from that. Okay. And just to very quick, I will probably go quite quickly through that. So people try to extract these galaxies from Tuma's point source catalog because it's deeper, and there was one attempt from this, and then also with my collaborators we thought what happens if you go beyond Tuma's and you merge only WISE and Supercosmos. The important thing here is that both WISE and Supercosmos, which cover the whole sky, are much deeper than Tuma's. However, there are issues with doing this because both are very prone to star contamination, and we made efforts to clean up stars, but if you look here clearly, there is a larger overdensity of sources close to the galactic plane than elsewhere. So although these are galaxy candidates, there is a stellar contamination in the sample. There is not much more we can do about it, but the thing is that we also computed photometric redshifts, and this catalog is also gradually used for some cosmology. No papers have come out yet, I think, but some are in progress about it. Just to show again, WISE, which is a catalog which is very close, so to say, to my heart, because I've been working on this data for a long time, and I have also collaborators and students in Poland who have been involved in trying to extract lots from WISE. So the thing is that this is one of the largest all sky samples. Gaia probably has more sources already, but in terms of the extragalactic sciences, still, I think, the largest all-sky sample. 100 million galaxies and a couple million quasars. Recently, there was a really nice paper on how to extract them. So it's much deeper than other all-sky surveys. And we showed in this paper that there are galaxies even redshifts larger than one. They are very specific galaxies then, because they are either very much redshifted or some specific very bright in the mid-infrared, but they are there. But it's difficult to explore the cosmological potential of this survey because first of all, the angular resolution of WISE is 5 arc seconds. It was a small satellite, 40 centimeters at mid-infrared, so you have lots of blending. And also, basically, stars are very bright in 3.6 microns where WISE observes, so they dominate. Even at high galactic latitudes, you have lots of stars. The thing is that, so we are trying to overcome this in some automatized ways, which are a bit similar to neural networks used for photometric redshifts, but a different approach of support vector machines. And we already had two papers on that and some more. And I think Artem, who is here, will show some related efforts on his student talk in a couple of days about this. I'm not sure. Artem, will you cover WISE or only Akari so far? Is Artem here? He went. Okay. So anyway, the point is that you can try to do some more automatized thing on that. And WISE is very, very useful and important for what is forthcoming. The thing is that you cannot get photometric redshifts from WISE. You only have two bands at full depth. So there is no way to get reasonable photometric redshifts from two bands. But you can match WISE with other surveys, and we are in the KIT survey, we are looking also in this, for instance, and you can then get photometric redshifts better because when you trace also this, a bit of stellar light and some other bands at 4 microns, then you can improve your photometric redshifts. And then with the forthcoming surveys, the radio ones, which I will mention in the next slides, WISE will be of lots of use because, again, in the local universe it traces the stellar light, in the far away universe it traces quasars, so radio surveys are sensitive to quasars. And also working with WISE gives you some idea how it will be working with future surveys, where I already mentioned that LSST will not be able to process on your computer. Already with WISE, it's a bit challenging to process it. If you have 700 million sources, you have to be a bit smarter. Then you cannot, save the whole table really reasonably in an ASCII file, which will have I don't know how many gigabytes of data. It's quite not such a large survey as for future standard, but already quite large. I mentioned already that there is a Taipan survey being planned, and here I give more details what exactly will be happening. So I said that TUMAS is a photometric only survey with photometric redshifts now, but there is a chance it will be fully spectroscopic. First of all, thanks to Taipan, which will target TUMAS galaxies in the south, and then there is a proposal from a Spanish group to measure the remaining ones in the north from a telescope in Spain. And this should give us a very nice all-sky redshift survey of about 1 million galaxies. Very useful for many studies. I don't say about them really in the slides, but for many local studies of cosmic web and cosmic flows, such a sample will be very, very useful. However, in most of these plots, you certainly saw this band here, which is our galaxy, which was just masked out because you cannot really infer cosmological information in there. Here the same. With TUMAS only, it's a bit better because in the near infrared, the galactic extinction is very small. So what blocks you to observe galaxies beyond the Milky Way is mostly the stellar light of our galaxy. So this is not such a big deal. But here, although this map is a bit tweaked, but at low latitudes you already have lots of incompleteness in TUMAS. So this is the so-called zone of avoidance, which was identified, I think, for the first time by Hubble. So I have to admit this. I think he called this the first time zone of avoidance. People later understood why this zone of avoidance, so that you try to measure nebulae and this zone is avoided by the nebulae. This is avoided because our galaxy is there. But you can try to penetrate through this, and I was involved in one very nice effort, not this one. The thing is that in the optical, in the infrared, in also X-rays and most of other bands, you cannot penetrate through the Milky Way due to different reasons. There is dust, there is gas, there are stars. But in the radio, in H1, you can do it, because if you look at galaxies at redshifts larger than zero, the H1 is redshifted, and you can measure the galaxy behind the galaxies behind the galactic plane. This is an example from last year, very, very nice. Here is the galactic bulge, okay? Galactic bulge you cannot penetrate with basically anything, but there are radio galaxies which are observed behind the galactic bulge, basically. So this is very nice. However, we still try to also go to the challenging part and to infer something in the optical, and in particular from a long-term project run by René Krahn-Kortefech, we managed to find that there is a supercluster of galaxies hidden behind the galactic plane, and our estimates show that it's first of all very close to Shapley in terms of the radial distance. On the sky it's not that far at all, but also it's probably quite close to Shapley in terms of its extent. But these are mostly speculations, that we made some efforts how to show what is the size of this, but this is mostly covered, and this plot shows why this is the problem. So the Shapley supercluster is there. This is an extract from Tuma's photometric redshift survey. Here, one redshift slice around 0.05. This is nicely at plus 30 galactic latitude, so this is nicely covered. But the Vela supercluster is more or less somewhere here, and here it's totally the light is totally blocked by our galaxy, so we can only measure these things and these things. But we have reasons to believe that they are, well, first of all, we know that they are at the same redshift because we measure spectroscopic redshifts of them, but also we have reasons to believe that they might be connected. But it's not proven, but anyway. If these are actually two superclusters, this is probably more interesting even, because they are certainly very, very massive. So, okay, so you really can try to measure the whole sky if you make lots of efforts, also joining such a sample of radio galaxies with all sky samples that I showed, almost all sky, is quite challenging. But it's, in principle, it's feasible. Okay? But another approach to go into large-scale structure, which I'm getting a bit gradually more and more interested, is to go into the radio domain, because there are large-scale surveys being run or planned. SKA is the future, but now there is already LOFAR happening, and there has been surveys which measure lots of the sky in the radio domains. And one which is of real legacy value now, almost 20 years old, was done with the Green Bank Telescope, NVSS. With the VLA and NVSS, and it's observing at 1.4 gigahertz. Was observing, and they detected quite a lot of sources, although not all of them are useful. Well, here this on the well. There are instrumental issues here, but not all of them are instrumental. Some of these are just due to low resolution of the plot. But well, on this map you maybe don't see, but there are some issues in the coverage of the survey. But this is a very interesting survey. There are no redshifts in there because this is just radio flux in a sense. But these sources are mostly at quite large redshifts because they are mostly AGNs or quasars. That's what people believe, that these are mostly AGNs in there. Then there was also an effort to go using the same frequencies, but to smaller sky coverage, but better resolution and larger depth. And all in particular, the sources were targeted. Well, it's within the SVSS footprint, so there are some of these sources do have redshifts, but again, it's a flux, radio flux survey in a sense. So this was a very interesting first survey, and people are trying now to do something more in the radio domain, and in particular, both SKA, which is planned, but also already existing surveys like LOFAR in the north, which is mostly in the Netherlands, but also all over the Europe, in particular close to here, if I remember correctly. We have three stations in Poland. So people now try to observe the radio sky at low frequencies, because these were not really observed a lot so far. And the main thing is the main challenge is that this is because of our atmosphere, which a lot interferes with observing at these frequencies. And for instance, in LOFAR, the major problem to produce easily catalogs is that you have to model the atmosphere on different time and space resolutions, basically on supercomputers. So for instance, LOFAR has a dedicated supercomputer which where you apply for observations for you want to make some observations with LOFAR, you have to also motivate how many, I don't know, millions or whatever CPU hours you will use on the supercomputer and why you really need this, because this is really challenging to observe. But it is possible, and in particular also in India with GMRT, people observed similar sky coverage as NVSS, but at very different frequencies, so an order of magnitude smaller. And there is a catalog where basically by eye you see that it does have issues, so lacking data and some runs of sensitivity here and there. But this catalog is now being upgraded because so these are people, basically my colleagues from Leiden, and they now got new observations. So this is also a probably promising catalog for future large-scale structure. But more promising is this one, and this is the first wide-angle catalog that came from LOFAR and which has mostly extragalactic sources. It's called LOTS, so this is the acronym here. At the moment, the catalog that is released covers just quite a small patch on the sky and with not very good resolution. But I know that already in this paper already it's shown that LOFAR can do better in terms of resolution. But as far as I know, there is no catalog and not very soon. But it's just to tell you that there is an interesting catalog, which you can, well, I'm sure that it will be useful for cosmology with once people overcome some issues. Well, again, if you look here, there are also some instrumental issues. If you see these rings, these are artifacts of source detections. Okay. And this is a plot from this paper by Tim Shimwell from the LOTS paper, which shows basically there are, well, kind of three dimensions of this plot, the frequency at which it is observed, sensitivity, so basically how deep you can go, and these are, the sizes are equivalent to sky coverage the sizes are equivalent to the resolution of the surveys. What is missing on this plot is the sky coverage of these surveys, but I understand it was quite challenging to add a fourth dimension to such a plot. This is already, this is what it was released, and then this is what is planned. This already exists, this exists, so this all exists, I think. This is planned, I think, and this is a precursor to SKA, and SKA will be, I don't know where here, but probably on many points in here, because also these are precursors to SKA, so LOFAR in a sense, but also GLIM. But where it will be in sensitivity, I don't know. It's you have to ask people who are in the SKA to tell you. I don't know if it's really decided because there are two phases of SKA being planned, and the first one is probably funded. The second one, I'm not sure. Okay. Well, and we're reaching the end. So, of course, the large-scale structure and the universe in general is observed at many, many other frequencies and with many, many other instruments that I wasn't able to cover quickly here. So basically from very small wavelengths to very large wavelengths, or large frequencies to high frequencies, and for instance near and mid-infrared and far-infrared satellite from Japan, Akari, observed the whole sky, also ROSAT in the X-rays, Galax in UV, and Fermi, which is still observing in gamma rays. Tomorrow I will mention briefly, I will mention by the end how Fermi can be used for large-scale structure. Just briefly, Fermi measures, first of all, sources from our galaxy, which are very bright in the gamma rays. This is this, familiar galactic plane, and most of these are, there are some supernova remnants, Vela supernova remnant, for instance, here. Fermi also measures a lot of extragalactic point sources, AGNs, for instance, and radio galaxies are also believed to be bright in the gamma rays. But except of this, Fermi also has a background in the gamma rays. In a similar way as we have the cosmic microwave background, there is also the gamma ray background. And it's not really known what this background is from. So in general, people believe that it should be made by unresolved AGNs and quasars, but also star-forming galaxies. When you have supernova explosions, also they emit in the gamma ray bands. But then also there are models of dark matter. If dark matter can be something which self-annihilates or decays, it should also produce gamma rays. So in general, there is lots of information in the Fermi gamma ray background, and by the end of tomorrow's talks, I will show how people try to extract this information with some specific techniques. The point is that basically from all these surveys, you can usually try to extract some cosmological information or at least large-scale structure information. It's not always straightforward to do this, but it's doable. So I think I will stop. Yes. So that's all for today. Okay.
Radio waves. You mentioned Lafar, as I heard, the Ukrainian decameter telescope UTR2 is still working, and for now Lafar and this UTR2 are almost at the same frequencies, and how can you comment or whether those data from UTR2 are using somehow, or it's just not considering as a working telescope?
Sorry, I didn't understand fully. You meant LOFAR and what other?
LOFAR and UTR2. In the past, till LOFAR appeared, it was the biggest world radio telescope.
Okay, I don't know much about it. Where was the telescope?
It's in Ukraine.
Ah, okay. I don't know much about it. Sorry. But if they observe the same sky areas, then they must have common sources.
It seems so, but I'm not expert. Yeah. I'm not working radio institute, so I don't know for sure. I wanted to ask you, but
no,
I understood.
Well, I only know. Well, I don't know. I know of LOFAR that finally they made last year this catalog, which can be used for some large scale structure. Although I haven't seen really papers so far that people really did use this catalog. From other surveys, I don't know. I don't have this knowledge. Sorry, so I cannot.
And another question. I just heard about it, and you haven't showed in your lecture, so it's like outstanding question about linear modulation. What is it?
Yes. So yes, I didn't mention about it much about it because so Lanyakia is a proposed structure that people identified based on the local motions of galaxies, so peculiar velocities, about which I will show one or two slides tomorrow. So briefly, just to explain, so except of the general radial Hubble flow, so the expansion of the universe, each galaxy has a peculiar velocity due to local matter concentrations. So you can think of it that you have the mean cosmological expansion, but also galaxies in fall on matter concentrations. That's how the clusters are formed, for instance.
Gravity.
Sorry?
Due to gravity.
Yes. And then you can measure these velocities, and you can measure the whole velocity field. And you can infer different different information from this. And in particular, because these velocities are related to how density is distributed, because galaxies fall on over densities, you can infer, in a sense, also the cosmic web from the velocities. Okay? So you measure only, you look at the peculiar velocity of galaxies, but you can infer the large-scale structure from that. And people propose the way of inferring a supercluster from this. The problem is that I'm a bit skeptical personally, because the peculiar velocities are noisy, and also the method has to assume some things. In particular, basically, in this, when you don't have measurement outside of some distance, you cannot infer anything from this. So you don't know anything, what is the outside matter distribution. Well, there you know a bit, but not much. because you cannot, well, the outside matter distribution does influence a bit the motions, but so, well, I don't see convincingly in more standard methods of identifying cosmic web, where people just look at galaxy distribution, I don't see convincingly that there is something like Lagrangian superclusters in which we are supposed to live. It was inferred from this method, it was proposed, and okay. It's a bit difficult to test it because to reapply this method, you would have to have a larger survey that they used, and this don't exist. This is mostly the problem. So, well, Lagrangian is supposed to basically encompass the local group of galaxies where we are, the Virgo cluster, and several clusters which are around us. It's hard to say whether it's a real thing, but also it is also, in general, superclusters in general are not well-defined things. Clusters can be defined quite easily because clusters can be set as something which decouple from expansion and they have radial infall, they are often virialized. Superclusters are a bit vague. You say, okay, there are conglomerates of clusters, but so for instance, people propose that you can define supercluster, which is something that will not dissolve in the future. Yes, so this is a well, then you can, and they showed actually that Lagrangian would probably dissolve, so according to this definition, it's not a supercluster, but it's just it's not like broadly accepted definition of a supercluster. So,
wait a moment, I don't know whether I followed everything, but you want to comment. Do you refer by any chance? Now, it is true, if you have a density perturbation, you have a perturbation in the upper flow. In fact, you have the delta V over V, where V is the upper flow. So the perturbation of the upper flow is proportional to the perturbation in the density, so to delta yes. rho over rho, yes. and depends from the density of the parameter density of the universe, omega, to some power. Okay?
Yes, in the linear regime.
Something
regions.
Like 0.07. Then, when you say, then, given this, on this decal, archai decal, okay, in the, some time ago, we are talking about back, I don't know whether you were discussing this, did a very careful analysis based essentially on this. And the computer model is the potent actual computer model, where it did show very clearly that he went not too far. I think he went down to personal a bit farther. And you see very clearly that via the velocity perturbation, you determine the density perturbation and so superclustering essentially. So,
yes, so this is the reconstruction method, basically, where you reconstruct
part is very clear, I mean, and so it's almost as clear as a cluster. I mean, you see, also because a cluster is a density perturbation of the world, where part is virialized and part is not virialized.
Yes, but the problem with Lagrangian is that it is almost as large as the observational box that was used for it.
So no, this well, is you can do more, but I refer to that because it was the beginning. So
no, I mean this is just.
And there is Jim Peebles wrote a book on the density perturbation on a large scale structure. Did you read the book by Jim Peebles?
Not the full book. It's a bit challenging. No, it's a general reconstruction method which I mentioned is that you can. Having only the peculiar velocities, you can reconstruct the density field. Then you can, of course, compare to the observed density field, you can infer, in particular, the beta parameter, which is related to the omega matter to 0.6, 0.55, basically. But you can also propose to use this reconstruction in a more specific way to define things, for instance, to look for voids in your observations, or to look for superclusters.
I could quickly come in, because I think we're having some misunderstanding here. So you're talking about potent and velocity divergence reconstruction based on relative component velocity. That's fine. And you define clusters based on density, Lanakia was not defined using density, it was defined using some properties of the reconstructor full 3D velocity field. So they do another step. They first reconstruct density and then reconstruct velocity based on this density reconstruction, one-dimensional component of velocity. And then they find Lanakia is the passing of the whole streamlines falling into the same kind of a velocity flow passing. So that's why it's kind of a really speculative, because they use two-step interpolation from the data. It's not only density, it's only full reconstruction of velocity.
Anyway, it's just from me. Well, Wojtek probably shares my view, but let's not. It is okay. It is a method, but in general, I still do believe that superclusters are not well defined in how people, because, as I say, it's quite appealing to me to say that supercluster is an entity which will not dissolve in the future. The problem is that it's not obvious how you can easily measure it because there are selection effects, etc. But in general, yeah, so there is no, I don't think there is a one accepted definition of what a supercluster is. It's usually
I agree on that. I mean, but the supercluster now we know is filamentary structure. I mean, I don't know what you mean by supercluster essentially.
I don't mean anything because I just agree with this definition. Well, I like this definition, but I don't mean anything specific. People call entities supercluster, Shapley supercluster, Lanyakea supercluster. Now we also have Vela supercluster. But you know, it's, well.
Well, but you mentioned also the work of Kranz Gottweg, which, well, okay, then.
Okay.
No questions? Yes, there is from me. You mentioned at one point that probably WISE or maybe another survey is the most complete up-to-date. So how do you define the completeness of the survey?
Well, I'm not sure if I mentioned complete.
You mentioned that some survey probably WISE,
so,
but
no,
it's the most complete.
Tumas, well.
Tumas or one of the survey.
Yeah, Tumas, well, you can only define completeness in some specific way. Tumas is the most complete survey in terms of in the near infrared up to the limiting magnitude that it measured, and also it's important that it's complete also to some angular size because the telescopes of Tumas had some I think three arc second resolution. So in this sense, the catalog made from Tumas is the most complete, meaning that it observed all the galaxies up to this flux in the K band, 2.2 microns, up to of sizes not smaller than 3 arc seconds.
That it observed all? Or
well, 99%.
Yes.
Well, there is always.
The question is mainly how do we define completely?
Well, you can only, well, you can try to infer from some, for instance, small area surveys. In particular, if they go much deeper, then you can infer the luminosity function or the number counts, and then you can infer if you take a telescope which goes to some smaller depth, how many galaxies you should see, etc. So this is more or less in that sense.
You base this on the model and on another survey with different technical
No, it's just, I mean, when you, okay, you have a telescope which measures something, and you just know what you detect on your CCD and what you don't detect. It's not. There are some design. This 1% means that you are. I don't know well how to quantify this, but you are quite sure that no more than 1% galaxies of these properties are missed by your survey. I think this is how you can define completeness in observational terms, but.
Questions. Thank you again.
I have an announcement for people who